studying and looking and all the different ways we can learn how to speak in public. I've listened to Brian Tracy, and I've listened to Les Brown, and I've listened to many different public speakers who have, you know, shared their knowledge. And a few statistics have come up, which kind of gets my attention. We as a group, practice, and we get up here, and we tell our stories, and we show what we've learned, and we get up here, and we're boisterous, and we're loud, and some of us are a little meek, but we tell our little story. But it's interesting enough that statistics have shown, and studies have shown, that on the phone when you're talking to somebody, the person only hears and retains 7% of what you've said to them. What they notice is your confidence and the way you say it and your energy level and what you really want to push are just those things. You want to push your confidence. You want to push your story. Well, strangely enough, when you're in person, they remember about the same, and they also still remember 38% of your confidence and the way you tell it and your mannerisms and but about 55% of it is how you look, how you stand, your poise, your posture. So as we get together and we share our ideas and we all practice and we all get up here and we do our speech in front of Toastmasters, we always got to remember the way we do it and how we do it with the inflections on the right lines, the rhythm of our voice. Pauses for inflection. That's what speaks to people. Because, again, you know, somewhere if you're public speaking or on the phone, you're looking at between 17 and 14% is all that they're really listening to. What they really care about is how we do it, our way we do it, and of course, the story we're telling. And again, they don't hear the story all the time. They don't retain the whole story. But they remember that Steve was excited. What Steve has, I'm not sure what he said, but he's excited about it. And I want to hear more. So you get that curiosity level up with the way you say it, the inflection. And of course, as Les Brown has said, we want to be consciously conscious of the way we speak to people, just because of that. If I get up, either in person or on the phone, and I just go, yeah, I've got something that's really neat. Would you like to hear about it? No, not really. No. All right, I'm done. But if you jump up, hey, I got something. You want to check it out, don't you? Whoa. What was that? I don't know what he said, but I want to know more. And so because of that, you've got to remember how. The action of how we do it, the inflection of what we're doing, the excitement and the curiosity we're passing on to our people. That's what we want to know about. That's what we want to share with other people. Because people don't know, people don't care about what you're saying as much as they care about you caring about them. We ask questions. We talk to people. We get the excitement going. We get the curiosity up. We let people know through our mannerisms, through our dress, through our posture, that we have something that we're proud of. We have something that we can share with them. And so when we tell them a story and we use the words that they're only going to remember 7 to 14% of, we want them to know how we did it, our inflection, our compassion, the variety in our voice to let them know that we're here with something special. We have something that can change their life. Now, again, whatever our story is may not fit everybody, but if we share it with everybody, then somebody in that group will listen, and it will help them. And that's what we're all here for. We all have a story. We all have something. And each week, multiple people get up and we tell a story. And I'll be honest, I'm in that 14% 7.14%. I don't remember everything that Dale told us 3 weeks ago, but I loved how he said it. Now, of course, I would remember Casey with that. But how he did it meant something more. When I hear the story about the fried chicken and puking later on, I can't tell you every little detail of the story, but I can visualize how he said it and how he stood over the chicken. So again, the story itself, the details, weren't what really stuck with me, but the compassion and the feeling of humor that hopefully came through, and all the little nuances of his voice. And getting choked up when Dale told the Star Spangled Banner. All these little things are what I remember. I don't remember the words. I don't remember every single word. But I know the feeling. And so when you're on the phone or you're in person, and when you're telling your story, remember, they're not hearing exactly every little detail of what you're saying, but the way you say it means so much more. The feeling you share with people is what they really want to know. As you go out this evening and throughout the next couple of weeks, as you give your speeches, as you talk with other people, remember, how you are speaks louder than what you are saying. And that is what we're here to learn.
Brought back a memory, and good speakers do that. Something they say triggers an emotion, a remembrance. I was in eighth grade, came to Nashville to the Grand Ole Opry for the first time, and I think little Jimmy Dickens sang Cold, Cold Tater and Wait, or some such song as that, and heard Roy Acuff and Bill Monroe, but really what I remember as vividly as anything was during the commercial break, when the guy doing the commercial was in a little glassed-in cage up there, and he was not talking to us. He was talking to this microphone. But he would say, "And so ladies, try Martha White Flower." And I thought, well, look at that. I mean, why is he gesturing and showing all that in his face when he's just simply talking into that little microphone? But you're never just talking into a microphone. It's you and your message flowing out in your words. And if you lock your face, and if you lock your gestures, you lock your expression. Steve always gives us something to think about.